The Bridal Chair is a work of biofiction by distinguished and prolific author Gloria Goldreich. The novel is based on the life of Ida Chagall, the only daughter of the artist Marc Chagall. Chagall used his brush to create a visual journal of Ida's life, as well as to depict the life, both joyous and profoundly sad, that he and his wife Bella led. They were forced to flee their beloved home in Russia, settling in Paris ultimately, but having to flee there as well at the beginning of World War II. Not unlike others, they had to leave everything behind, possessions and people, and they had to live with profound loss. Ida's relationship with her father was complex. She adored him, was in awe of his talent, but became the parent to the wildly egotistical and often childlike Chagall. Ida was responsible for his survival, as she facilitated his petulant departure from Europe at the beginning of World War II. While frustrated with his willfulness and selfishness, Ida also profited from her father's talent. She managed his art business, making them both very wealthy. But ultimately, Chagall betrayed the daughter who devoted her life to him. It's quite a story. Most of Gloria Goldreich's works are fiction and explore the attributes of brave and complex women, enriched and encumbered by family relationships. She's an expert on women, and on Jewish women in particular. Gloria Goldreich is my guest today. I'm Alice Bloom. This is A Town and Village Too. Welcome back. Gloria, thank you so much for being my guest.
My pleasure to be here.
We've been talking about getting together for ages, so I'm so glad that we finally achieved this. Now tell me, I know the word historical fiction, but I'd never heard the word biofiction before.
Biofiction is basically taking a personality, working within the chronological reality of her life, being adhering to all the historic circumstances that informed her life, but creating a fiction around her. In other words, inventing conversations, embroidering relationships, introducing characters who may or may not have existed for her.
Okay. Do you feel that a reader should know that before they start reading it, that this is not historic? I mean, we can't take everything as gospel, that it really happened this way.
The history, the chronology, where she was at a particular time, the place where she was, and what was happening historically is all absolutely accurate.
But how about her relationships with her first husband and the second husband?
Her relationship with her first husband, I relied greatly on Jackie Walschlager's wonderful biography of Marc Chagall. And I embroidered on that as well. And I did a great deal of research. So I think I got most of it right. I hope I did.
Well, are there any Chagall family members alive today?
Yes. Ida's two daughters, the twins, Merit and Bella, are alive. Merit lives in Switzerland, and Bella runs a flower shop in Greenwich Village. In answer to the next question, did I consult them about the book? I did not. I don't know till now whether or not they have read the book. I mostly did not consult them because the name Chagall is pretty much in public domain, and I didn't want to have to constantly ask a family member for permission or credence or to confirm accuracy. So I stayed away from that.
Well, I actually was not going to ask if you had consulted them about writing the book, but I was going to ask you if you'd had any reaction from them about the book.
Not at all. And I don't know whether to be grateful or sad about that.
Okay, well, it's not been out that long, so maybe...
March.
Okay, well, that's not a terribly long...
Not very long.
Okay, so it's about 6 months or so. Now, one of the things that was profoundly well done in this book, and I know I've used the word profound a lot of times, is the sense of place.
Well, the place was very important to me. I went to Nice, where Chagall had lived on the Riviera for some years, and I stayed there, went to the magnificent Chagall Museum in Nice, so I got a real sense of the life he had lived when he was painting and in his not his two marriages, because his relationship with Virginia, the second woman in his life, was not a marriage, but with his life with Vava. And I also went to St. Paul de Vence, where he's buried. So I got a sense of that whole area. And of course, I went to Paris. I visited the Rue de l'Arche, where Ida had her home, and the various places where Chagall lived with Bella. So place was important.
But it was very important, because you start out and he's living in Paris. And but we're also transported back to Russia. I mean, I don't know how to say the name of the town.
Vitebsk.
Vitebsk. Okay.
Vitebsk was the shtetl village where he and Bella came from,
right,
and which was an important part of his youth and an awful part of his oeuvre. He painted Vitebsk over and over and over again. But interestingly enough, he never went back to visit. He didn't keep in contact with his sisters who survived the war and were left behind. He was complex in his attitudes.
He was complex, but that was sort of a consistent inconsistency with him. I mean, there were so many situations like that. I mean, Judaism was a big theme in his work.
That's very complicated also. He painted rabbis, he painted Jewish rituals, he painted Jewish suffering, particularly in his crucifixions, which depicted a crucified Christ wearing a tallit, a Jewish prayer shawl, and there are several crucifixion paintings because he saw Christ as the suffering Jew. So he had a real consciousness of Jewish suffering, but he himself never went into a synagogue, or rarely went into a synagogue, observed no rituals. Very complex. It was almost a negation in life of what he was doing in his art.
Well, there were so many strange things about him, and I wondered if you would ever talk with someone who actually knew him.
I did. There's a woman living in the South, an American woman, who met with him several times. She had a very idealized portrait of him in her own relationship, but as she talked, I heard the kind of hesitancy she had about him as a person. I should say that when I originally started researching, I had thought to write about Chagall himself, not about Ida. But as I read more and more, I found myself actively disliking Marc Chagall, but feeling a closeness to his daughter Ida. So I switched my authorial headlights and focused on Ida.
You know, that's interesting you bring that up, because I've read many of your other books, and I always felt you concentrated on the female characters and knew them and depicted them with such accuracy as far as emotions and relationships and situations. And men were peripheral, not that they were short shrifted, but they weren't developed to the same level that, or we didn't get quite the same insight as you explored in women. Not in this book. In this book, I felt that Chagall and Ida were rather evenly attended.
I think so. They had a very symbiotic relationship. And I focused on that. They were very dependent on each other, and things about Chagall informed Ida's own life.
Oh, clearly she was very influenced by her father. I mean, there's one scene at the beginning, he would paint her nude well into her adolescence or young adulthood.
He painted her nude when she was 15 years old, and the nude painting appeared in and this is actual, mm-hmm, it appeared in a publication called Les Cahiers de Paris, and it wasn't unusual for him. He saw the woman's body as something of great beauty. That it happened to be his nubile daughter didn't disturb him, nor did it disturb Ida. And in my thinking, I don't think either of them should have been disturbed by it. It was art. It was not pornography. It was not exploitation. It was sheer art.
And yet there was something kind of off in their relationship. And somehow I feel this tied into it. I mean, there is a point where a parent and a child distance themselves a little bit. I mean, I think it's necessary for the child to attain some independence. And I think that Ida didn't really achieve that until much later in life.
She didn't remain the child. She became the parent. She cared for Chagall. She managed his personal life. She managed his business life. In a very real sense, she was responsible for him.
But she exercised good and rightful authority in places where he was being childish and very, very poor, exercising very poor judgment. For example, when the time came to leave Europe.
He was very arrogant in terms of his own fame. He felt that the Nazis would never touch him because he was too famous, although they have touched everyone. They touched Thomas Mann. Why would he be exempt if Mann, who was a Nobelist, was not? So he consistently refused to leave, and she consistently urged him on until it became apparent that he was as vulnerable as every Jew was in Europe from 1933 to 1945. So it was only at her urging and through her machinations that they were able to leave.
When do you think she started to realize that her father might be something of a predator? And maybe I'm using a harsh word, but it seemed that she was devoted to him. He was so difficult. I mean, she would manage his career and the money, and he would constantly be demanding more and more from her, to the point where she was compromising her own personal life.
I don't think she saw him ever as a predator. I think that word would not have occurred to her. I thought she saw him as hopelessly dependent and incapable of functioning without her, and in a way, that was true. That was true. She was able to save him from Europe only by contacting Varian Fry. And I'd like to talk a little bit about Varian Fry.
Sure.
Because he's a very important historic figure. He responded to Eleanor Roosevelt, who, unlike Franklin, was determined to do what she could to help endanger Jews, particularly Jewish artists and intellectuals. So she financed Varian Fry's project, which meant he arrived in France, in Marseille, which was not yet Vichy occupied, with pots of money that Eleanor Roosevelt was able to get him, and he was able to arrange visas for countless Jewish artists to leave. George Grosz, Marc Chagall, a great many. And he did it. He was not Jewish. He was a Harvard aristocrat, but he put his life on the line for the Jewish intellectual community and was responsible for saving them. Now, here's another aspect of Chagall. When the war ended, Varian Fry was in a very bad state, and the people he had saved decided to do an exhibit of their paintings to honor him. And they donated paintings, and Chagall was asked for a painting. And he said, if they want a painting, they will have to buy it. So again, you have a man who is saved by another man, and yet didn't have the generosity of heart to do something for him.
Right. Well, there are other words for it. I mean, it's what's puzzling to me is that we all revere Marc Chagall's work so much.
I know.
There are
not
exhibits.
Anymore.
Well, but this makes us look at the work differently. I mean, we appreciate the work, but
it's a question of whether we revere the work or the artist. Mm-hmm. Now, many writers and artists and sculptors and musicians are simply not personally admirable people, although their work is fantastic. So we can't throw out the baby with the bathwater. We continue to revere the work. I continue to revere the paintings, but I have hesitation about the artist. It's sort of Charles Dickens. Mm. Charles Dickens was terribly cruel to his wife. left her without any means of support. I love Dickens as a writer. I have contempt for him as a person. So,
but why do you think that Chagall's nature has been kept largely under wraps for so long?
No one attacks a saint. I didn't mean to attack him. I don't see my book as an attack. I see it as a confrontation with unfortunate reality.
See, I didn't see it as a confrontation. I saw it as a developing personality. And I think we saw how he lived his life, which was not necessarily so admirably. And what we see here is the daughter who is really devoted to him. She starts out as a young, bon vivant. I mean, she doesn't know where she's going or what she's going to do, and she has one little mishap, and she's punished by her father in such a way. When she becomes pregnant...
When she became pregnant, he insisted on an abortion, which was perhaps a wise thing to do, but then he insisted that she marry...
a man she didn't love.
She might have loved him.
She was too young.
And he was too young. But they insisted on it, both Marc and Bella. Now, you can trace that back to their shtetl background. They were constantly in search of respectability. If you came from a very tiny Orthodox Jewish community, you felt yourself vulnerable to the judgment of that community. So Ida had become pregnant. It was probably known, which was a blow to their respectability. But if she was married, she was safe, and their respectability as a family was guaranteed.
Was salvaged, even though she had become pregnant out of wedlock. And yet, if he had left it there, that would have been enough. But then he painted the bridal chair, which was his gift to her, his wedding gift to her, which was not depicted as a happy bridal chair.
No, it was monochromatic. Completely monochromatic. It was a white chair,
a shroud,
white flowers.
I think you
it was shrouded,
it.
White flowers. There was in front of it a very dull pink rug. But what was interesting, there was a painting within a painting. He painted his own gift to Bella, which a painting in which he flies towards her, bringing a gift. So, within his daughter's bridal chair, he inserted himself in a lesser way. It was a very complicated, but then for her second wedding, he gave her another gift. He created out of ceramics a full dinner service, and that was a happy gift because it was for a more mature woman who was marrying into prestige and money in her second marriage.
Interesting. I just felt that the first gift was kind of a documentation of her mishap or of her unhappiness. And, you know, here we made you become a righteous woman, and now, but we're not going to let you forget.
But it was a bridal chair without a bride.
Without a bride.
Yeah.
Which is a little bit odd for sure. Now, let's talk a little bit about Bella and her relationship. Now, she was not so well. I think you depict her as either bipolar.
If Bella was living today, we would have called her a neurasthenic. Okay. She was given to depressions. They were earned depressions. She had lost most of her family. Mm-hmm. They were endangered by the war. Mm-hmm. She was profoundly affected by what was happening to her family. She had gone from a very wealthy household to fleeing with Marc and living for a while in poverty. Mm-hmm. And all this impacted on her. She was shy in her own way. And she had yearnings to be a writer, which were never fulfilled. Everyone around Marc pretty much sublimated their own needs to what he wanted. So in her later years, she began to write her biography. It's a book that was finally published called The Burning Lights, which he had illustrated. He did sketches for it, but that was late. So she became very withdrawn, very depressed, and Ida became sort of both wife and daughter.
Right, she stepped in. But more than that, once Bella died, Ida also became a procurer for her father.
Twice.
I mean, this was really hard. I mean, first, it's one thing to find a housekeeper.
Well, that's what she thought she had found. When she met Virginia Haggard McNeil, she met her, I don't know exactly how she met her. I created the meeting in the park, but they did meet. And what she noticed was two things, that Virginia spoke fluent French. Marc Chagall, through the years that he lived in America, never learned English, never bothered learning English. He spoke only two languages. They must have spoken Russian, but he also spoke Yiddish. He thought in Yiddish, he dreamed in Yiddish, and he spoke French. So he went through countless housekeepers who didn't understand him, which enraged him. So Virginia spoke French. Virginia needed money desperately because she was married to an older man who couldn't make a living, also an artist, by the way. And she was a very skilled housekeeper. She knew how to sew. She knew how to clean. So Ida hired her as a housekeeper. It seemed the perfect solution. But eventually, not eventually, it took weeks before she and Mark became lovers. And they did. And
they never quite married, although they did have a child together.
They never married. They had a child. He would not marry her because he wouldn't marry a non-Jewish woman. They had a child. He was in Europe when he also wanted her to have an abortion, and she refused because she was not 18 years old. She wanted the child. So they had the child, and he accepted the child as his son. In fact, the child went through a ritual circumcision, which Chagall said made him Jewish, but of course it did not make him Jewish. But he accepted David. He was named David for Chagall's brother, who had died in the Crimea. Until Virginia left him. And when Virginia left him and took the child with him, he renounced the child as well, until Ida interceded and got him to recognize the child and offer him support.
And whatever happened to David?
David became a jazz musician. I don't know where he is now. I don't know if he's still alive, but I did read. One of my sources was a book called My Life with Chagall by Virginia Haggard McNeil, and she wrote about David.
Okay, because he kind of, we know that that Ida advocated for him, but we never find out what happened to him later on. There are some themes that made me want to forgive Mark, even though I really disliked him. I mean, you come away from this and you say, as you said very aptly before, we can appreciate the work, but this was not a very nice man.
To me, I thought he was a very bad man.
A very bad man in a lot of ways. But then I was always torn between what he and his family went through. Of course, leaving their home in Russia for the first time and having to lose everything. I mean, we who've never experienced that kind of loss don't know what it's like.
No, he had a very tragic life, there's no question. First of all, he left Russia. He had welcomed communism. He had welcomed the revolution. But almost immediately, the communist revolution turned anti-Semitic, and he had to run. He ran to Moscow, where he and Ida worked in the Yiddish theater, painting wonderful, wonderful scene sets that were on exhibit at the Guggenheim not too long ago. And then he had to flee Moscow. He went to Germany. Germany was just at the beginning of what would be fascism. So he had to flee Germany. That was the second country. Then he went to France. Who could have ever believed that France, liberté, égalité, fraternité, would become a Nazi stronghold, which it did. The French occupation is a very sad one because Vichy France and Pétain compromised and fell into fascism. So
this sadness followed him, and you know, he was constantly fleeing, embracing the wrong the wrong political challenge or the wrong socialist challenge and having to leave and having to start all over again. That's not an easy thing to do.
No, no. His life was not easy, but you know, Alice, no one's life is easy.
No, it doesn't forgive the ultimate betrayal, which at the end was so surprising to me. I did not know that. Once again, Ida has found him a housekeeper, a lover, his next wife.
She didn't bargain for Vava either.
No.
Vava was a very, I think she is one of the most malevolent, manipulative characters that I can think of. But Vava knew what she wanted. She wanted to be Madame Chagall.
Right.
And she wanted the money, and she wanted Ida out of his life.
But that's what surprised me. That she wanted the money didn't surprise me. But Ida was responsible for the very deft handling of his art business. It would seem to me that she'd want her, perhaps on a salaried basis or something like that, but to continue that.
No, she wanted her out of Mark's life. And it was a very painful kind of thing for Ida. There was also a kind of religious problem. Vava was born Vava Brodsky. Mm-hmm. She was Jewish, but she was kind of fascinated with Catholicism. There's a general theory that she actually converted. Nobody knows for sure. But she got Mark very involved in doing work for churches later on. If you go up to Pocantico Hills here in Westchester, the Rockefeller Church in Pocantico Hills has the most stunning Chagall stained glass windows, and she got him commissions at churches. Now, the interesting thing is, I said that I went to his grave in St. Paul de Vence. He and Vava and her brother, who was also named Michelle, oddly enough, Michelle Brodsky, are buried in the same crypt. There is nothing, it says their names, Marc Chagall, Vava Chagall, Michelle Brodsky. There is nothing Jewish on the grave. It's a municipal cemetery. The neighboring graves are both Catholic graves with large crosses.
I see.
And
well, and what a turnaround, because most of his life he wouldn't enter a church. He wasn't interested in going to a synagogue, but he certainly didn't go to a church either.
But well, he did art for churches.
Right.
And he began going into churches when Vava was married to Vava.
Did Ida ever write her story?
No.
She never told it.
No. She had the end of her life. I stopped at a happy time. The end of her life was not so happy. Her marriage to Franz Mayer ended in divorce. She became, according to Jackie Wolfslager, she became an alcoholic, and she died in Paris in her late 70s.
Oh, how sad.
Very
sad. Because she does emerge here as a heroine that we can
embrace.
But
she was a heroine.
She certainly
was.
She was
a heroine.
Gloria, it's been such a pleasure to talk with you. I can't wait for your next book. I hope it's already started.
It's in the computer.
Okay, next summer for sure.
Okay,
will
Alice,
you come
I
back?
Hope so. I'd be delighted to
well,
come back.
Well, it would
back.
Be my pleasure.
Thank you so much for a wonderful interview.
It was my pleasure. And thank you at home for watching. I'm Alice Bloom. We'll see you next time.